Magandang araw sa inyong lahat at welcome sa isa na namang video kung saan ay makakapulot kayo ng impormasyon patungkol sa abnormal pediatrics at care of the high-risk infants. Kaya kung ikaw ay isang nursing or midwifery student at gusto mong mas mapalawak pa ang iyong kaalaman sa mundo ng nursing at midwifery, aba, nasa tamang channel ka na. Ako nga pala si Teacher Jeff Lay, isang nurse midwife at clinical nurse educator, at tutulungan ko kayo para mas maintindihan ang mga concepts patungkol sa inyong napiling kurso at profesyon. Kaya tara, simulan na natin! Sa video na ito ay matututunan nyo ang mga problems and care related to post-term neonates o yung mga sanggol na sobra sa buwan. Lagi nyong tatandaan na bilang isang future nurse or midwife, responsibilidad nating alagaan ang lahat ng uri ng mga sanggol kahit paano ang kanilang kondisyon. Kaya mahalagang malaman ninyo ang appropriate care and nursing managements natin sa mga ganitong klaseng pasyente.
The next problem that is related to gestational age is post-maturity. These are what we call post-term infants. Ano pa kasi yung tinatawag natin na post-term? Paano natin ikakategorize kung yung isang bata ay post-term po? When we speak of post-term infants, they are born after the onset of the 42 weeks of pregnancy. So, pag lumampas po siya sa prescribed na 42 weeks AOG, more than 43 weeks na po yung isang pasyente na buntes, we can already consider that pregnancy as post-term. Okay? So, usually, the doctors will prescribe labor induction if the pregnancy is already 2 weeks post-term. So, kailangang ilabas na yung baby if it is already 2 weeks post-term. Bakit? Kasi we are trying to prevent the post-term syndrome. Okay? Kailangan natin maiwasan na magka-post-term syndrome yung bata because that can be life-threatening. So, sir, how do we induce labor? So, the patient who is post-term na yung pregnancy, they can subject her to cesarean section delivery or they can also induce labor through giving of oxytocin to the patient. Okay, so ang importante doon is mailabas na po yung bata bago po siya magkaroon ng post-term syndrome. Hindi po pwedeng magtagal ng sobra-sobra yung bata sa loob ng sinapupunan because it can lead to, like I said, post-term syndrome. Anong ka kasi yung post-term syndrome na paulit-ulit kong sinasabi? When we say post-term syndrome, the infants or the fetus who remain in utero with the failing placenta may die. We all know that the placenta will also lose its capacity if it's already way past its prime. Ibig sabihin, the older the fetus gets, the weaker the placenta is in performing its function. So, the more na nagtatagal po yung bata sa sinapupunan, the more din po na humihina si placenta to perform its functioning. And what will happen? The fetus stays there in the womb while the placenta is not absorbing the needed oxygen, nutrients, or blood from the uterus. Ang mangyayari is that magkakaroon po ng deprivation of the needed supply for the child to survive. So, the placenta, like I said, only is effective for 40 weeks. After this, the placenta loses its function. Kaya nga po tayo may theory of aging placenta na habang tumatagal, nalulose ni placenta yung kanyang function. Therefore, pag nagkaroon dapat ng scarcity of blood and oxygen na mafe-fill ni baby, dapat siya mismo yung kusang lalabas. Alright? So, that is what we call post-term syndrome. Once kasi na nagkaroon po ng losing of placental functioning at bumaba yung oxygen level ng bata, tendency is magkakaroon siya ng reflex relaxation of the anal sphincter leading to meconium, the passing of the meconium leading to secondary pneumonia. Maaaring magkaproblema po yan pagkalabas. Alright? So, that is what you call post-term infant and the post-term syndrome. Now, how do we assess a post-term patient? Okay, so aside from doing the LMP, pwede din po nating i-subject yung ating mga pasyente na buntes to ultrasound or sonogram. So, ano pong importante na gagawin natin dito is that we measure the biparietal diameter of the fetal skull. Titignan natin kung gaano kalaki yung ulo ng postterm fetus in relation to the measurements of the hip or the pelvis of the patient. Bakit natin kailangan gawin ito is that we want to rule out cephalopelvic disproportion. Titignan natin kung kakayanin ba ng patient natin na post-term pregnant na mag-labor. Kung kakayanin niyang mag-normal spontaneous delivery or vaginal delivery. Kasi kung merong cephalopelvic disproportion, masyadong malaki na yung ulo ng bata in relation to the pelvis of the mother, then they may consider not going through trial labor, diretsong CS na po yung pasyente. Alright? So we can also do non-stress test or what we call the complete biophysical profile. Bakit po natin gagawin ito? We want to look into the adequate placental functioning. Diba nga po yung non-stress test, tinitignan natin how well the placenta is doing when it comes to absorption of blood. So, yun po yung gagawin natin. So, the moment po that the patient failed the non-stress test, then it's time to deliver the patient by doing cesarean section or by inducing labor through oxytocin incorporation to the IV. Okay, they can also do amniocentesis. Okay, so pwedeng kukuha sila ng sample ng amniotic fluid to determine lung maturity by surfactant detection. So titignan natin kung complete na ba yung formation niya ng kanyang surfactants, or they can also test the presence of meconium in the amniotic fluid through amniocentesis. Okay, so if the postterm infant have inadequate placental functioning, or meron na pong nakita na meconium, that's the time that they do emergency CS to deliver this postterm fetus. Now, ano nga yung mga itsura ng postterm newborns? So, these postterm newborns may have these kinds of appearances. They have dry, cracked, or leather-like skin which lacks fluid. And there is also an absence of vernix casuosa. Bakit? Saan nawala yung vernix casuosa? It has already been reabsorbed in utero, or it may also be swallowed by the newborn. Kasi nga nagtagal na siya doon sa loob, kaya baka nakain na niya yung vernix casuosa or na-reabsorb na siya ng skin ng fetus. Aside from that, they are lightweight. Bakit sila magaan? Because of a recent weight loss, because of poor placental functioning. Hindi po kasi nag-absorb na ng dugo and nutrients to supply the demands of the fetus. Kasi nga po, nalulus na ni placenta yung kanyang functioning. Kaya, it's very typical for us to see postterm infants who are lightweight. They also have overgrown fingernails that is beyond the end of the fingertips. Okay, so mahahaba na po yung kanilang mga kuko. Bakit? Kasi nga po, masyado na silang nagtagal sa loob. Therefore, yung mga kuko nila lumaki na rin halos. And then they also displace the alertness of a two-week-old baby. And then they may also be meconium stained, and there may also be less amniotic fluid kasi nga baka nainom na ito ng post-term fetus na ito. So this is usually the appearance that we see in a post-term newborn. Now, what are the problems and care that are related to post-maturity? So number one na problema again natin dyan is difficulty establishing respirations. So dito naman po, the difficulty of initiating breathing is not caused by the lack of lung maturity, but it is caused by the presence of meconium, which may be aspirated because of the effects of anoxia. Gaya ng sinabi natin, if there is low oxygen level in utero, pag yung bata nakaka-feel na konti lang yung nakukuha niya na oxygen, nagkakaroon siya ng anoxia, magkakaroon siya ng reflex relaxation of the anal sphincter. At pag nag-relax yung anus, lalabas si meconium, leading to meconium staining. Pwedeng ma-inhale or ma-aspirate ng baby ito, and then it goes to the lungs, leading to meconium aspiration. So, pwedeng magkaroon din ng secondary pneumonia ang mga post-term infants. Alright? So, anong gagawin natin paglabas immediately ng bata? We don't do back rubbing. And we also don't give high pressure oxygen. Bakit? Kasi pag if we initiate the newborn to cry immediately, eh alam nating meconium stained yun. The child will inhale the meconium deeper into the lungs. So, hindi din po tayo agad-agad magbibigay ng oxygen na high pressure because we might be pushing the meconium down deeper into their respiratory tract. Okay, so we prevent the backflow of meconium by not doing back rubbing, by not stimulating the baby to cry, and by not giving high pressure oxygen administration. Instead, what do? We immediately intubate the child for deep tracheal suctioning to remove the meconium that are inhaled by the post-term infant. Alright, so aside from that, we also have hypoglycemia, which is a common problem for these types of patients. Meron silang hypoglycemia because of the insufficient source of glycogen. Kasi nga po, they already have used some of their supply of glycogen in utero. Kasi nga po, the placenta is not anymore doing its function of supplying the demands of the body of the post-term infant. Kasi nga, it has already lost some of its functioning. Okay, so some of the glycogen have already been consumed. Therefore, because of poor placental functioning. So what do to prevent this type of problem? Immediately, we can allow the child to breastfeed. Minsan nga yung mga batang post-term, hayok na hayok silang umiinom or nagsasak because that's how hungry they are. So that is one way for us to alleviate hypoglycemia by giving them breastfeeding. Aside from that, we can also insert an IVF and then the doctor may also prescribe D5LR or pwedeng D50-50. So 50% sugar po ano? D50-50 yung ibibigay natin sa mga pasyente, 50% dextrose usually to prevent hypoglycemia. Aside from that, we also have thermoregulation problems. Bakit tayo may thermoregulation problems or mahihirapan silang mag-regulate ng kanilang temperature? Because of the lack of subcutaneous fats. Diba po, sinabi natin kanina that these types of newborns usually are usually lightweight kasi nga naubos na nila yung mga subcutaneous fats nila because it has been converted by the body into energy. Into glucose kasi nga hindi na po nagpa-function ng mga EGC placenta kaya yung mga fat stores niya nagamit niya. And because of the lack of subcutaneous fats that are already used in utero, they may have problem regulating their temperature. So what do? We protect the child from chilling and we transport the child to a special care facility, placing the child in an infant warmer, or drying the child immediately, or doing kangaroo care. So, yung mga diniscuss po natin last time, those are all plausible na procedures to alleviate thermoregulation problems. Aside from that, they may also have polycythemia or too much RBC. Okay, this may be present because of lack of oxygen in the final week. So, anong ginawa ng bone marrow ng bata? Sabi niya, uy, wala na tayo masyadong oxygen. And the body may think, baka kulang lang tayo sa RBC na nag-carry ng oxygen. So, the bone marrow will create more blood to compensate for the lack of oxygen. So, anong nangyari? Dumami ng dumami yung RBC in the hopes of increasing hemoglobin. So, anong nangyari? Because of that poor placental functioning, nagkaroon siya ng polycythemia. And that will also lead to elevated hematocrit due to polycythemia and lower plasma volume. So, usually, the doctors can prescribe IVF or intravenous fluids to alleviate these conditions para ma-saturate po natin yung ating dugo or para ma-dilute po natin at ma-alleviate yung elevated hematocrit and polycythemia, dadagdagan po natin ng fluids yung bata. So what do we do? Or what can be the interventions that we can provide these patients? Number one is we can do health teaching, okay? We give health teaching to the parents regarding the need for closely monitoring the baby for meconium aspiration and hypoglycemia. So dapat, we instruct the mother na misis kahit dahil po nagtagal yung bata sa loob po ng inyong sinapupunan, hindi po ibig sabihin na siya po ay super healthy. You still need to look for signs and symptoms of difficulty of breathing and hypoglycemia. Alright, so sabihin po din natin sa kanila that they may also be predisposed to having a secondary pneumonia because of meconium aspiration. So, pwedeng magbigay tayo ng health teachings sa ating mga patients, especially sa mga mothers and other significant persons caring for the child to look for signs and symptoms that are reportable. We also give emotional support to the mother because they may also have guilt feelings of not providing her child the nutrients it needs. Diba nga, sabi niya, oh, yung placenta ko kasi hindi nag-function ng maigi kaya naging ganito yung bata. They may feel guilty or they may blame themselves for not being sufficient, especially when it comes to their placental functioning. So sabihin po natin, misis, wala naman pong may gusto ng nangyari and wala naman po tayong control sa functioning ng inyong placenta. So there is no need for you to blame yourself. So we empower the mother by giving her emotional support. You listen to her, let her verbalize her emotions. Aside from that, you also advise for provision of follow-up care until at least school age. So dapat po regular check-up po yung ating mga pasyente for us to be able to track neurologic symptoms because their lack of oxygen because of in utero, ano? Because of the failure of the placenta to supply the oxygen needed by the child may have caused developmental delay. So, maaaring yung low oxygen levels, maaaring napektuhan po yung utak ng bata, kaya dapat kailangan natin siyang itrack yung kanyang mental development delay at least until the school age. So, you ask the parents to conduct regular check-up or meet with their healthcare providers as much as possible for us to determine kung nagkaroon ba ng developmental delay because of post-maturity.
At dyan na po nagtatapos ang ating recorded video tungkol sa problems and care of the post-term neonates. Nawa ay marami kayong natutunan sa akin. Kung gusto nyo pa ng mas maraming informative videos, please support my channel by liking, subscribing, and sharing my contents. Again, ako po si Teacher Jeff Lee at hanggang sa muli, paalam!